You have questions? America's number one business coach has answers. It's your Broda from Minnesota. Here's another edition of Ask Clay Anything on the Thrivetime Business Coach Radio Show.
Yes, yes, and yes, Thrive Nation. On today's show, I get the opportunity to answer the question that I get asked the most. So hopefully I do a good job of answering it. I mean, I've answered this question so many times for so many people that hopefully I now do a good job of answering the question. The question is, what do I need to do today to become successful tomorrow? What do I need to do today to become successful tomorrow? All right, I'm going to walk you through the steps. I will tell you there are eight steps. So you're going to have to take notes here. There's eight steps. There's little kind of sub-points for each step, but take notes on these steps here. Step number one, you need to write down your F6 goals. What? You want to write down your goals for your faith, your family, your finances, what? Your friendships, your faith, your family, your finances, your friendships, your fitness, and your fun. It's very hard to get somewhere if you don't know where you're going or where you want to go. It's very hard to know if you've gotten to where you want to go if you don't know where you want to go. So I encourage everybody out there to write down your F6 goals. But Clay, if I write down my goals and I don't achieve them, I get depressed. Okay, well, that's loser thinking, and that could probably be a different show, but you need to go ahead and write down your F6 goals. All right? Step two, you want to change your calendar and your daily schedule immediately. So I'm going to help you save a whole bunch of time right now. As an example, immediately cut all television out of your life.
But I like to watch Ricky Lake reruns. But what if I'll die?
Well, I mean, cut all of the television that doesn't make you money. I mean, maybe there's a show you like to watch that's very awesome and it helps you make a lot of money. But I would just say for the average person, according to all the research I can find out there, I mean, USA Today did a report, the New Yorker's done a report. The average American right now is wasting 5.2 hours per day watching TV. That's 5.2 hours per day watching TV. And this just in.
That's a lot of TV.
So I would encourage you to just stop watching TV. So many people say, the reason why I don't have time to have success is I'm running out of time. I'm just so busy. The reason why I can't have success is I'm just so busy. Well, if you stop watching 5.2 hours of TV per day, that's going to free up a lot of time, per day. 5.2 hours a day times 7 days a week times 52 weeks a year, that's going to save you 1,892 hours a year divided by the 40-hour work week. That's going to save you, just an insane amount of time. I would encourage you, just go out there and stop watching TV. The average American, just so you know, this is kind of crazy, the average American watches 5.2 hours of TV per day, 5.2 hours of TV per day, which equals 47.32 work weeks per year. That's like having a second job. So stop watching TV. Move number three. Step number three. Again, step one. Clay, what was step one? Step one was write down your F6 goals. All of them. Faith, family, finances, friendship, fitness, fun, and post it on your mirror. Someplace very clearer. Someplace where you can see the goals on a daily basis. What? Yeah, because if your face doesn't see the goals on a daily basis, it's very hard to know whether you're heading towards the goals or drifting away from the goals. Write down your F6 goals and place them somewhere where everybody can see them. Step two, change your calendar and your daily schedule immediately.
Should I change it slowly over time?
No. Rip the Band-Aid off, baby. Rip the Band-Aid off. This just in. It's now time to rip the Band-Aid off.
Holy cow.
If you're not happy about the life you've been living, rip the Band-Aid off and write down your F6 goals today. Step two, stop watching TV today. Be done with it. 5.2 hours of TV per day. 47.32 weeks per year. Stop watching TV.
But what if I die? Because if I die, I'll be dead and then I won't even know what's going on.
Step three, turn off all of your social media notifications immediately. Immediately.
Immediately?
Yeah, immediately.
La, 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 Luke. Luke.
It would be be more productive to spend your day talking into a box fan saying,
"La la la, Luke,"
than spending your day on social media. It would be more productive to spend your day in a hot tub trying to sell ice cream to people in the hot tub. Yes, welcome to my hot tub. This is Clay's hot tub, and in the hot tub of love, we selling some super sexy dark chocolate. We got some extra special, super special strawberry. We've got some peppermint that I just love. No, it's not a good use of your time. It would be better to be going door to door trying to sell phone books.
The new phone book's here! The new phone book's here!
Well, I wish I could get that excited about
nothing! Are you kidding? Page 73, Johnson, Maven, R. I'm somebody now! Millions of people look at this book every day!
There's so many things that you could be doing with your time. Why in the world are you on social media 2 hours per day? What are you doing? What are we doing? Psychology Today wrote a subtle article called "Your Smartphone is Destroying Your Life."
But what if I get off social media and I die?
They wrote, your smartphone, the title is, "Your Smartphone is Destroying Your Life." It says, here's another disturbing statistic. This tally seems to increase daily. But by one study's count, the typical smartphone user, not you, other people, interacts with their smartphone 85 times per day.
Well, that's great, because when I have my smartphone on, I'm only interacting with it 45 times a day.
And that often includes middle-of-the-night checks for work, emails, and new likes. What are we doing? America. Not America. People on other planets. The Philippines, people in Samoa, people in Alaska, people in Canada, Australia, people all over the world. What are we doing? Why are we on social media so much? Ron Friedman, PhD, Psychology Today, writes, studies indicate that even brief interruptions exponentially increase our chances of making mistakes. This is because our attention is diverted by our smartphone. We use up valuable cognitive resources, reorientating ourselves, leaving less mental energy for completing our work. Research also suggests that frequent decision-making causes us to tire. My friends, get off the smartphone. Get off of the TV and write down your F6 goals. Clay, could you repeat it from the top without yelling? Okay, step one, write down your F6 goals. Your goals for your faith, your family, your finances, your fitness, your friendship, and your fun. Step two, change your calendar and your daily schedule immediately. Immediately do not watch TV anymore. It's 5.2 hours of TV per day that you're throwing down the drain. For all the guys out there, if you want a more productive thing to be doing than watching TV, just pee into your gas tank and see what happens. You get the feeling of like you're exploring nature, you're having a good time, you're wild, you're getting to just express yourself. And when you urinate in a gas tank, tell me what's a better use of your time, urinating in the gas tank or watching 5.2 hours of TV per day or 47.32 work weeks per year, which oddly enough is more time than the average American actually spends at work nowadays. Step three, turn off all of your social media notifications. Your likes, your hearts, your followers, unless they're paying you, get off of that. Quit wasting your time creeping on other people, seeing what other people are doing, comparing yourself to other people. It's just not a good use of your time. Step four, get up and plan your day 1 hour before you see your first human. What? Yes, get up 1 hour before you see your first human and plan your day. We call this meta time, meta from the Greek word meaning above. You could call it planning time. You could call it, I like to call it prayer time. That way it seems a little more. You could call it, it's my morning tea time. It's my time when I get up in the morning and I just decide to plan out my day while I have my tea. That's fine. I don't care what you call it. You could call it, well, I tell you what I do in the morning, I call it my kicking some butt time, because I get up in the morning and I plan out my day and I just kick some butt. I don't care what you call it. I really don't care. Well, man, I tell you what I call it. I call it getting up, before everybody else is up, because that's when everybody's asleep. You get it? I mean, you can call it whatever you want to call it. I don't care. Good Lord, I call it the time when I'm alone, when people aren't so noisy. I call it my quiet time. I don't care what you call it.
Well, Clay, I call it the time when I wake up and I no one else is up. I call it that time.
It doesn't matter. Don't get all hung up. Don't worry about it, whether it's meditation time or prayer time. Just get up 1 hour before you see everybody else and plan your day. Step 5. Not batting cleanup, but close. Automate your savings. Automate your savings. What does that mean? I mean, you need to go talk to the company who pays you. Say you are an employee, or say you are an employer, but you get your check from Paychecks, you get your check from Paycom, you get your check, whoever you get your check from. Just automate your savings. Decide to save a set percentage of your income. In our office, an incredible man by the name of Andrew Bloomer has decided to save an incredible 25% of his paycheck. He and his wife, Manna, have decided to save 25% of their paycheck. And guess what's happening as a result of them deciding to automate their savings? They have saved 25% of their paycheck. Now, the Federal Reserve, those fancy people at the Federal Reserve, they did a little research, and here's what they found. They found that 40% of adults, regardless of age or income, still cannot cover a $400 emergency expense. What? 40% of adults still cannot cover a $400 emergency expense. And I'm putting a link to the survey on the show notes. My friends, you've got to automate your savings. If you want to become successful, that's what you got to do. Now, step number 6. You want to commit to over-delivering by 20% on every project you touch. So if you have a job today or you have customers today, you want to make it your goal, your little game, to exceed the expectations of each and every customer, each and every person that you engage with on a daily basis. Whether that be your boss or your customer, which is the boss, you want to make sure you exceed their expectations by 20%. Make it your goal, because even if you fall short, you will still wow them. And when people are wowed, they will share close to now.
Now on to step 7, which rhymes with Kevin. So if you're out there and your name's Kevin, big congratulations to you. Step 7, refuse to spend time with negative people who are perpetually emotional, negative, and drama-focused. Again, refuse to spend time with people who are perpetually emotional, negative, and drama-focused. Tim Ferriss, the best-selling author of The 4-Hour Workweek, The 4-Hour Chef, Tools and Titans, Tribe of Mentors, one of the early-stage investors in Facebook, Twitter, Evernote, and such, he says, you are the average of the 5 people you associate with most. So do not underestimate the effects of your pessimistic, unambitious, or disorganized friends. If someone isn't making you stronger, they're making you weaker.
But that sounds so mean. It might sound mean, but it's so true. I mean, it just is. If you're, as an example, I have been married to my wife now for, we're going on 18 years. I'm 38 years old. I have 5 kids. If you were to shadow me, follow me around for 1 week, you would realize that my schedule is something that I'm in control of. I have a very intentional schedule because step 1, I wrote down my F6 goals this morning, and I write it down every morning. So I have a very intentional schedule, right? So 4 in the morning, I go work out, right? 4 in the morning? Yeah, 4 in the morning, I go work out. Then at 5 in the morning, I review my notes for the day. I do my meta time. It takes about an hour, right? 6 o'clock, I have my first staff meeting, right? And I have a very intentional schedule. 7 o'clock is my first client meeting. At 8 o'clock is my next client meeting. At 9 o'clock, and you would just watch me go from meeting to meeting, but they're all in 1 hour intervals, and it's because I've designed my schedule to work that way. And you'll notice there'll be time blocked out for the radio show to talk to advertisers. There'll be time blocked out to do sales calls. There'll be time out to have staff meetings. There'll be time out to coach clients. There'll be time out to. There's a specific block of time for everything I want to get done. So everything I want to get done has a specific allocated amount of time for it. There's no randomness to my day, right? Because I have written down my goals. And then step two, you would notice that my calendar is probably very different than that of the average person. My schedule is. I don't watch TV. So there, I have 5.2 hours of more. I have 5.2 hours per day more time than anybody else out there typically because I don't watch TV. I also don't interact with social media at all. So I have another 2 hours a day. I have 7.2 hours more per day than the average person. And because I've scheduled time for the things that matter, I don't have like an empty day where I'm sitting around doing nothing. I just have taken those 7 hours a day that people are spending on 5 hours a day on TV and 2 hours a day on social media, and I've replaced it with other things that are scheduled, right? And then step four, you notice I get up, you know, 1 hour before I see my first human. You notice that I automate my savings. You notice that I have committed to over-delivering by 20% on pretty much every single thing I do. It's just sort of a thing I do. It's a mindset I have. It's a commitment I have. But if you were around me enough, you would notice that my habits would start to become your habits. I would start to, if you were around me enough, you would notice that you would start to automate your savings. You would notice that if you're around me day by day, eventually it would be uncomfortable for you to not automate your savings because I would probably bring it up to you anytime there's downtime. So if you and I were having coffee together, fictitious world where I went up for a coffee, I would sit down and I would say, hey, so how are you? And you would say, so why are you talking with a deep voice like that? And I would say, well, why are you talking in that weird whisper voice? You would say, well, I just, that's how I talk. And I'd say, okay, well, I'll continue to talk like I'm from the Civil War or something, but I want to ask you this. Have you automated your savings yet? Have you automated your savings? Well, no, I haven't. Really? Well, here's the deal. If you will stop not automating your savings, I'll stop talking like a Civil War veteran, and you can stop talking like the whisper voice. Does that sound like a deal? Okay, I guess I could, okay. Well, point is, you would notice that I'm always using funny voices or voices that I perceive to be funny. I'm always talking about automating your savings, automating my savings, and I would just continue to harass you about it to the point where it would be uncomfortable for you to be around me. Also, if you don't appreciate humor and that kind of thing, you wouldn't like me because I'm always joking around. I'm always having a good time because I just enjoy having a good time. So again, if you're around me enough, you would become a fairly funny person because I am never done joking around, giving people a hard time. That's what I do. My kids are around me enough that my daughter is becoming funny. My oldest daughter is becoming pretty funny. My son is becoming pretty funny. All my kids are becoming pretty funny. Why? Because they're around me all the time. It's like, I talk about this a lot. I've talked about this on previous shows, but if you're from Minnesota, where I'm from, everybody in Minnesota has these little phrases that they say and their way of saying it because it's like a Minnesotan accent. And if you live in Minnesota, a lot of people who live in Minnesota aren't even aware that they have the Minnesota accent. But this is the kind of thing you would hear if you're in Minnesota. If you're in Minnesota and something is really nice or some, if you were to go to someone's home and their living room is nicely decorated, you might say, oh, for cute, Bjorn. I mean, for cute? What in the world? Yeah, in Minnesota, people also say, so what was that about? Come on, Bjorn. They say, what was that about? A boat. It's not about, it's a boat. So what was that about, Bjorn? Another thing people say is they say, ofta. Ofta. A lot of times, like if something, you know, bad will happen, it's like, ofta. Whenever you're upset with someone in Minnesota, you would call them a hoser. A hoser. One who hoses. You would say, oh, you want a hoser. You are a hoser. Another thing people do is everyone's going up north for the weekend. And if you lived in Oklahoma or any other part of the region, you would say north, and you'd end it with a th, north. But in Minnesota, you'd say, oh, we're going to go up north to the cabin with Rauschendorfer, don't you know? And you like to end statements with, don't you know, in Minnesota. A lot of people just say, don't you know. In Minnesota, people don't ask you, you know, do you want to come with me? They say, do you want to come with? It's a wit, not with, but, oh, don't you want to come wit? And again, if you ask someone in Minnesota, how are you doing? The typical answer is you know, typically not, oh, it's great, or things are good, or I'm doing wonderful. In Minnesota, people say, oh, I can't complain. I mean, it could be worse, don't you know? There's a lot of that stuff. It's what people do. In Minnesota, people fish on frozen lakes in the winter. They will actually drive their vehicle on a frozen lake. People will drive a completely solid, in great condition, you know, let's say big Ford truck, onto a lake, and there's no emergency. They're doing this willingly. They're not doing this because there's an emergency. They're not trying to save somebody. They will drive their perfectly good vehicle onto a frozen piece of ice known as a lake. Then they will drill through the ice with a device called an auger, and they will put a house on the ice and heat said house to room temperature, and they will sit in the house known as the ice house or the fishing house, and they will sit there for hours, put the pole in the hole, and they are ice fishing. And this is totally normal for these people. If you're in Minnesota and you don't have a snowmobile and you have a pretty decent income, people wonder why. It's just people have snowmobiles. It's just what they do. If you're in Minnesota and you don't know who Prince is, you know, if you don't at least know a purple rain, you're probably, you know, it's probably, you know, you're probably not from Minnesota. That's just how it is. Because over time, you become more like the people you're around. It's just what happens. Through osmosis, you begin to pick up the character traits of the people that you spend the most time with. And you might say, well, what's osmosis? Osmosis is the gradual or unconscious assimilation of ideas and knowledge. It's the gradual unconscious assimilation of ideas and knowledge. What? It is the gradual unconscious assimilation of ideas and knowledge. Osmosis. There you go. Osmosis. I wonder if you knew that. Now, step 8. You want to study successful people at every chance you get. There's a notable quotable from Colin Powell. Colin Powell, he's the American statesman and a retired 4-star general in the United States Army. During his military career, Colin Powell also served as the National Security Advisor from 87 to 89, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, commander of the U.S. Army Command in 1989. He's the first African-American United States Secretary of State serving under President George W. Bush. He says this: never receive counsel from unproductive people. Never discuss your problems with someone incapable of contributing to the solution. Because those who never succeed are always first to tell you how. Not everyone has a right to speak into your life. You are certain to get the worst of the bargain when you exchange ideas with the wrong person. Don't follow anyone who's not going anywhere. Again, don't follow anyone who's not going anywhere. Someone says, I want to hear that again. Don't follow anyone who's not going anywhere. Someone says,
holy cow.
You know, you should probably stop playing that sound clip. I'm going to play it again. Again, Colin Powell says, don't follow anyone who's not going anywhere. So I would encourage you today, just look at these 8 steps again. Step 1, write down your F6 goals. Step 2, change your calendar and daily schedule immediately. Get rid of that TV. Stop watching the TV. Step 3, turn off all of your social media push notifications. Get them out of here. Get off that. That gives you 7 hours a day back right there, guys, between TV and social media. Step 4, get up and plan your day 1 hour before you see your first human. Step 5, automate your savings. Step 6, commit to over-delivering by 20% on every project you touch. Step 7, refuse to spend time with people who are perpetually emotional, negative, and drama-focused. And step 8, study successful people at every chance you get. And now, without any further ado, 3, 2, 1, boom! Thrive Nation, I want to sneak in one little bonus snack pack here for you. It's kind of like your mom packed your lunch and she added in a little snack pack. Just a little bonus. I want to cue up an audio testimonial for you of a guy who was once a school teacher who became a client of mine. I've worked with him now for 7 years, and I had to teach him all of this stuff. I had to teach him time management, sales, marketing, how to make a new schedule, how to pal around with different people, how to say no to things, how to, you know, not watch TV, how to not engage in social media, how to refuse to spend time with emotional people, how to study successful people, how to commit to over-delivering by 20%, how to automate his savings, how to do all these things. And now today, he has become a millionaire. He's a former school teacher turned millionaire, and his name is Clay Stairs. And he agreed to sit down with us to share how the actual implementation of what he's learning has changed his life. So without any further ado, here is the Clay Stairs story.
My name is Clay Stairs. I am the founder of ClayStairs.com and the Leadership Initiative. Growing up, as I went through middle school and as I went through high school, I was pretty much a big fish in a small pond. And so I felt I had an overinflated sense of self. So once I graduated from college, I might have been like a lot of folks, graduated from college, terrified. So I ran to ministry, ran to the church really quick. From there, I jumped into being a school teacher. But all the while, I knew there was something more inside of me. I took over Shepherd's Fold Ranch, which was a summer camp and retreat center. But then once again, now here I am at about 47 years old, and I'm feeling like it's time. There's this shift beginning to go on. Like, okay, at this place, I've done what I've needed to do. It's time for me to expand. It's time for me to grow. But I didn't know anything about how to run my own business. As I made that shift from being the executive director of a nonprofit organization into running my own company, I found out really quickly where my weaknesses were. I've got to know something about sales and marketing and all those things that terrified me. And so it was about at that time when we were doing some fundraising for Shepherd's Fold Ranch that I met a young man named Clay Clark. Clay would tell me, it's just a formula. Do these things and outcomes production, outcomes money. I just didn't believe him. Yeah, it was probably just there in the first month, maybe 6 weeks with Clay, that I got my first speaking engagement. But when we started talking about money, I totally locked up and just said, I'll just come down and do it for free. But after that first few months, it was like I stepped off a cliff and all of a sudden everything stopped. And so Clay started talking to me about making phone calls and beginning to do that, making 100 phone calls a day. I was like, are you kidding? No one has ever done that. In the history of man, Thrive has provided this confidence that I didn't have before. And as a result, I've been able to turn a $2,500 or a $3,500 deal into $10,000 or $12,000 through working with Clay and working with Thrive. I've been able to look through the lens, not of my capacity, but I've been able to look through the lens of my destiny.
And you might say, okay, that one seems a little bit woo-woo, a little bit out there, a little bit far-fetched. I don't want to become a speaker guy. I want to grow my pest control company. Okay, well, I'm going to cue up an audio testimonial for you from a couple by the name of Jared and Jennifer. And this is the story of how they were able to successfully grow Platinum Pest by 400% within 12 short months as a result of implementing the things that we teach great people like you.
The number of new customers that we've had is up 411% over last year. We are Jared and Jennifer Johnson. We own Platinum Pest and Lawn and are located in Owosso, Oklahoma. And we have been working with Thrive for business coaching for almost a year now.
Yeah. So what we want to do is we want to share some wins with you guys that we've had by working with Thrive. First of all, we're on the top page of Google now. Okay. I just want to let you know what type of accomplishment this is. Our competition, Orkin, Terminix, they're both $1.3 billion companies. They both have 2,000 to 3,000 pages of content attached to their website. So to basically go from virtually non-existent on Google to up on the top page is really saying something. But that's come by being diligent to the systems that Thrive has, being consistent and diligent on doing podcasts and staying on top of those podcasts to really help with getting up on with their listing and ranking there with Google.
And also, we've been trying to get Google reviews, you know, asking our customers for reviews. And now we're the highest rated and most reviewed pest and lawn company in the Tulsa area. And that's really helped with our conversion rate. And the number of new customers that we've had is up 411% over last year.
Wait, say that again. How much are we up?
411%.
Okay. So 411% we're up with our new customers. Amazing.
Right. So not only do we have more customers calling in, we're able to close those deals at a much higher rate than we were before. Right now, our closing rate is about 85%, and that's largely due to, first of all, like our Google reviews that we've gotten, people really see that our customers are happy, but also we have a script that we follow. And so when customers call in, they get all the information that they need. That script has been refined time and time again. It wasn't a one and done deal. It was a system that we followed with Thrive in the refining process. And that has obviously, the 411% shows that system works.
Yeah, so here's a big one for you. So last week alone, our booking percentage was 91%. We actually booked more deals, more new customers last year than we did the first 5 months, or I'm sorry, we booked more deals last week than we did the first 5 months of last year from before we worked with Thrive. So again, we booked more deals last week than the first 5 months of last year. And it's incredible. But the reason why we have that success is by implementing the systems that Thrive has taught us and helped us out with.
Some of those systems that we've implemented are group interviews. That way we've really been able to come up with a really great team. We've created and implemented checklists. That way everything gets done and it gets done right. It creates accountability. We're able to make sure that everything gets done properly, both out in the field and also in our office. And also doing the podcast, like Jared had mentioned, that has really, really contributed to our success. But that, like I said, the diligence and consistency in doing those in that system has really, really been a big blessing in our lives. And also, it's really shown that we've gotten the success from following those systems. Yeah.
So before working with Thrive, we were basically stuck. Really no new growth with our business. And we were in a rut and didn't know.
The last 3 years, our customer base had pretty much stayed the same. We weren't shrinking, but we weren't really growing either.
Yeah, and so we didn't really know where to go, what to do, how to get out of this rut that we're in. But Thrive helped us with that. They implemented those systems, that they taught us those systems. They taught us the knowledge that we needed in order to succeed. Now, it's been a grind. Absolutely, it's been a grind this last year. But we're getting those fruits from that hard work and the diligent effort that we're able to put into it. So again, we were in a rut. Thrive helped us get out of that rut. And if you're thinking about working with Thrive, quit thinking about it and just do it. Do the action, and you'll get the results. It will take hard work and discipline, but that's what it's going to take in order to really succeed. So we just want to give a big shout out to Thrive, a big thank you out there to Thrive. We wouldn't be where we're at now without their help.
Thrive Nation, I hate to slap your baby, but you're not going to have any success unless you implement what you're learning. Vision without execution is hallucination. Once again, Thomas Edison once wrote, "Vision without execution is hallucination," and he was right.